Good evening, and welcome to Writers on Writing. We come to you every Sunday and give you, our listening audience, an opportunity to hear about writers from the African diaspora talk about their work, their lives, and their craft. We come to you from Medgar Evers College in Brooklyn, New York, WNYE 91.5 FM. We come to you every Sunday from 7 to 7:30 p.m. My name is Clarence Reynolds. I'm the director at the Center for Black Literature, and I'm pleased to be the guest host of Dr. Brenda Greene, the executive director at the Center, and of the National Black Writers Conference. This evening we have with us Ms. MOROWA YEJIDE. I hope I pronounced it correctly. I'm sorry. Anyway, MOROWA is the author of the recently published book, Time of the Locust. And congratulations, MOROWA, because the book comes out today, correct?
Yes, it does. Thank you very much. I'm really happy to be here.
Thanks so much. Can you tell us a little bit about Time of the Locust? Because I find it a very intriguing book and a very interesting story about a protagonist that we don't often hear about or read about in literature.
Well, sure. First of all, thanks again for having me here. I'm MOROWA YEJIDE, and Time of the Locust tells the story of a 7-year-old autistic boy and his supernatural relationship with his incarcerated father. Really, at its core, the novel explores different worlds, different kinds of imprisonment. It explores autism, solitary confinement, health issues, vengeance, and ultimately transcendence from these states. So Time of the Locust is really a journey into the duality of the lives of these characters. I really tried to look at light and dark, land and water, what's hidden and what's visible, challenge and triumph. But more than that, really, we fire a walk with these characters on their pilgrimage, kind of pilgrimage to their own truths. And that's something I think people often spend a lifetime doing. I would agree with you that these are not the typical characters you would see in a fiction story. And I think I've always been fascinated by what's uncharted or what's unknown or what's unusual. And I really don't write starting from a character in mind. Rather, I start with concepts and then build the characters that sort of personify those concepts.
Okay. Can you tell us a little bit about what was the genesis for the story?
Well, again, I think the mysterious, the magical has always fascinated me. I often start with a story. I start with an image and then a question. In the case of Time of the Locust, I ask the question, you know, if you couldn't talk with someone, how would you tell them what you feel? And Safiri, the young boy, is what you would call nonverbal. He's non-communicative on the autism spectrum. So he can't talk. He's aware of the world, but he can't talk. His mother can't communicate with him. And I guess it all sparked from one day I was reading, just really flipping through a magazine, and there was this article, and it had a photograph of an autistic boy. And this kid was looking up at the sky in this photograph, and there just seemed to be an entire world behind his eyes. I mean, he really, really seemed to be someplace else. And so Time of the Locust is an exploration of what that someplace else might look like through the lens of magical realism.
Mm-hmm. That someplace else is a world that you created called the world of water, which is where 7-year-old Safiri lives. Do you mind reading just a little bit of the book for us, please?
Sure, I'll read a section from the first chapter. Safiri had been drawing furiously, and at the height of his fever, he snapped his crayon. He threw the drawing down and watched the paper slide under the table. He was angry that his hand had not been able to keep up with his mind, one of the many things that frustrated him about being in the land of air. He couldn't stand the different regimens and schedules that were not of his own making, how the people were always telling and talking and asking until it all became a sort of noise that ran together in his head. This place was filled with air, not water, where he felt at home. He could float out to the realness of his world of water, where the sea was an endless expanse, as turquoise as the liquid in his bathtub, where he didn't have to try to understand the strange sounds of words dripping from mouths. He could head to his desired destination anytime he wanted, with only his little wooden boat gliding toward the three great black rocks that rose from the ocean. The dolphin waited for his company there, and the great octopus sat in majesty in his iridescent lair on the ocean floor. What concerned him in air did not concern him in water. He did not need the laws of physics to rein in his terrors, frustrations, and confusions there. He did not need to spin or bang or rock or flap. He could forget about the creatures flying in his dreams, the voice in the giant black box, the meaning of sounds and faces and smiles. He could forget about the words of air and speak freely in water, where the language of men was as indecipherable to him, to his friends of the deep, as it was to him. An encrypted thing to ponder briefly and release, like the dialogue of wolves and birds in flight.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Let me ask you, were you writing for a particular audience when you were writing the book, particularly any particular sections about Safiri or about his mother?
No. Writing is a very, very solitary activity, as you may have heard from other writers. It's, you know, and it's just me and the screen. And the audience is the furthest thing from my mind when I write anything. Instead, I'm always thinking about how I'm going to convey a kind of mythology that I'm trying to build in a story through character. And I guess in a way I'm a little bit like Safiri in the sense that I like writing for me is going to another world, mm-hmm. and I can kind of paint the tapestry as I go, and that's the thrill of it. I'm kind of along for the ride as well.
and we're on for a wonderful ride here as well when we read this book. Now, the two main characters which you mentioned, Safiri is an autistic boy, and he's 7 years old, and his mother is suffering from some health issues. I was just really curious that you have these two main characters that are both not what you consider to be heroic characters, so to speak, in a novel. Can you give me a little idea about where these characters came from or how you came about developing them?
I think, the boy Safiri and his mother Brenda, and really the other characters in the novel, they're composites of many, many different kinds of people, some who I have met, some who I have heard of, some who I've been inspired by. And they represent the themes that I'd like to focus on in the story, the sort of mythology, if you will, that these characters shape. So from that basic foundation, I wanted to look at certain kinds of characters that we don't often see in stories. We don't often hear about the internal challenges of a seven-year-old boy like Safiri, or the internal challenges, the everyday war and triumph of single moms like Brenda. They're too busy doing the work and doing their thing to really stop and reflect a whole lot. So I try to develop characters who represent the layers that make up people. I shun the one-dimensional. It's very, very important to me not to create sort of one-dimensional plastic characters. Mm-hmm. I'm more interested in why someone might behave the way they behave. And that figuring out why is part of the fun in building these unusual characters.
Great. Now, there are sections of the book that are devoted solely to Safiri, and then there are sections devoted to Brenda. And the sections with both of the characters, but particularly with Safiri, are just filled with such imagination. I was interested to find out what kind of research did you conduct or dig into to find out how an autistic person might think or how an autistic person might react to certain situations? Did you conduct any special research? Did you have, where did you go? Who was there anyone that you talked to or any particular person or instances that you observed?
I think it was a combination of things. Again, I like to explore things. So I did, aside from a lot of reading, reading the multitude of materials about autism, many of which showcase what we still don't understand. I mean, autism is really still a great mystery, one of the great mysteries of the mind still, and that was one of the reasons why I was very interested and curious about it. But I felt I learned the most about this mysterious condition by observing just hundreds of home videos, even, that parents of autistic children themselves put on the internet, you know, clips of what their day was like, and then reading what these parents shared about what their day was like, you know, what their children were like, what autism looks and feels like at any given time. I also had the tremendous fortune of talking directly to mothers of autistic children, and they were tremendously inspirational to me as a mother. I'm a mother myself with three boys, and I think motherhood pretty much is the same across the globe, regardless of what challenges a particular child might face. Parenthood, for that matter, is the same, I think, for many people. And then more than that, paintings by people with autism themselves give the what I feel the ultimate window into the mind. You know, paintings of landscapes and the deep sea, for instance. Places, you know, the moms have told me these are places these kids have never been, but somehow they can see and they can show these places in a painting. You know, it's remarkable, and I wanted to capture that in a story.
And you do it very well with this book. You mentioned that you're the mother of three children, three sons. Can you please tell our listeners a little bit about yourself and your journey in deciding to write fiction? Or was fiction your first choice or first love? Or have you decided to write, or have you ever, you know, moved into poetry or any other type of creative writing?
I guess it's, you know, I did dabble in poems and little stories ever since I was a little girl, you know, very young child. I was writing little stories and all. But, you know, as I grew and got into career, I ended up doing a lot of technical writing, a lot of research-based writing, nonfiction. It was always about technology. But I never really, you know, I was always really, really concerned about engaging the reader, or really trying to communicate what I was trying to say. So I guess that strand of that invisible communication between the writer and the person reading something was always important to me. I kind of write organically. I write different parts of a story all at the same time, and then I kind of assemble them together, like a quilt kind of. Mm-hmm. I published many short stories over the years, and I started with short stories so that writing complete chapters that kind of plunge the reader into a character at a moment in the story was something I was able to extend into a long-length novel. So parts of Time of the Locust, for example, started really as short stories. I published a few of those, and I kept going with that. And then, you know, when I was pregnant with my third son, my youngest son, I had a lot of long nights, you know, where you're trying to get comfortable sleeping. So I was up a lot of wee hours, and I used that time to sort of enter the world of fiction again. And see if it still filled me with the wonder it had when I was a child. And, of course, it did.
Great, great. Now, like I mentioned earlier, this is your debut novel, correct, that you've published, which comes out today. The book is published by Atria Books. Can you tell me a little bit about, you mentioned briefly or hinted on your process what's the process for you in getting a story just where you feel comfortable with it? Can you talk a little bit more about that? What is your process for writing? Do you write earlier now that you've had your third son? Do you write early in the morning? Do you write in the evenings? Or do you do a lot of research first? Or you just sit down and just begin writing with a particular thought in mind? I hope that's not too much.
You know, I wish I had that writer's life that you hear and read about, you know, where there's the roaring fire and the cabin and all. But no, you know, I write whenever I can. So it's usually really late at night or really early in the morning, or it could be in between, you know, a bunch mm-hmm. of stuff. I'm pretty good, you know, being a mom and having to work and all. I've gotten really, really good at compartmentalizing. So I'll say to myself, I'm going to block out this amount of time and just crank out as much as can come to my mind. Most of the time I have stories in my head, then I kind of work them over in my head while I'm doing other things, and then I'll zero in and put it to paper. Mm-hmm. I look at writing as a way to explore different things, so I research as I write. Something will occur to me, and I'll say, oh, yeah, what about that? And then I'll jump on the Internet. And I've found that the most wonderful things purely by coincidence, looking for something else. And a lot of those things, that kind of aha moment I have, I'll end up incorporating that somehow in a story. I think for me, it's part organic and part methodical. The organic part, the creative part, is very much free-flowing. I kind of liken it to seafaring. You know, I feel like I'm kind of going to float out there in the ocean and see what comes my way, see what I see out there. And with stories, I mean, I've always loved literary fiction and magical realism. So, right. You know, I always, when I sit down and write, I always liken that to, you know, I'm going to try to go out as far out into the ocean as possible, you know, to see see how far I can get my imagination to go. And then I'll rein it in with, you know, the revisions and the editing. That's all the technical aspect of it, where you have to be very exacting on, you know, what it is you're trying to convey.
Right. You mentioned magical realism, and as of recently, we just lost several of our, you know, most beloved writers.
Yes.
Garcia Marquez is one of my favorites, and we just recently lost Maya Angelou, who just had such a profound influence on the lives of so many people. Do you have any literary favorites, and what is it that you admire about the author or their work?
Yes, it's difficult to talk about writing without thinking about Maya Angelou, but, you know, I always admired her just towering strength, and, you know, she's been quoted on many things, of course, but I always loved how she said, you know, something to the effect of, you know, I wasn't just going to sit, you know, in the darkness, sit and curse the darkness. I lit a match, you know, and
right.
I just love that, lighting a match. And to me, that's what a lot of these literary luminaries do. Toni Morrison, I have always adored her for her mastery in showing the complexities, the layers that make up a character, and what drives that character. To me, Song of Solomon is a masterpiece in that regard. William Faulkner
mm-hmm.
and Cormac McCarthy are favorites of mine for the sheer imagery of their prose. And I'm not talking about The Road when I'm talking about Cormac McCarthy. I'm talking about his older works like Blood Meridian,
right?
Where some of those passages, I mean, it's like a painting. By the time you finish the end of the passage, you can literally see this awesome sort of tapestry. I love, of course, another great giant that we've recently lost is Gabriel Garcia Marquez. And just 100 Years of Solitude, again, a masterpiece. I admire him for his genius in weaving magical realism into his stories, you know, that fantastical element, and he puts it right next to the everyday mundane, and I just think it's wonderful.
Great, great. I know exactly what you mean there. Let me ask you, talk about Maya Angelou's lighting a match. What do you think is the duty of a writer? Do you think that it's important that a writer change a reader's perception about a person, about or persons or a situation? Or is it important for them to also make a social, some sort of social statement in their work?
That's a terrific question. I think literature, like everything else, people, when they come to the pages of a book, they're coming with their own perceptions, their own preconceived notions, their own judgment calls. And I think it, you really can't subtract that from the equation or keep someone from doing that. But I think as a writer, what you can do is shine a, or you can put something under a microscope and allow the reader to have a closer look. And through that closer look, they might gain more of an understanding. It might not change their view necessarily of something. I don't think you can really control what people end up thinking about anything that anyone writes. But I think that a greater scope of understanding, a greater depth of what someone is about or character is about or what that character represents is really more valuable. And I think that's probably part of why humans over the millennia do still enjoy stories, you know, storytelling as a way of understanding someone else, but also as a way of understanding themselves. And so I think if you're going to talk about responsibility, I think the writer really has a responsibility to get that focus of the lens as clear as possible in the context of the story. And if they're going to bring up a social theme, try as best as to the best of their ability to really show what is involved in whatever that social theme is, and you know, and not just go with the pat. There are many unlikable characters in many stories, including my own. But even with an unlikable character that I might be dealing with, even though I might be appalled by certain things that this character represents, I'm more concerned with painting as clear a picture of this character, what makes him tick, what brought him to where he is, and why he or she is, and why he or she is doing what he or she is doing.
Great, great. What are some of your passions, Maroa?
passions. So, obviously, reading is one. I enjoy gardening. I enjoy art, looking at visually striking art, I think is a fun pastime I have. And, I mean, even at my politics and prose reading on the 22nd, I'm going to be featuring four paintings of artistic artists.
Oh, fantastic. Where is it going to be held? Politics and Prose, that's in...
Politics and Prose in Washington, D.C. And, you know, I was really thrilled because I was able to... These were paintings that I came across just in passing on my own. And two of them, I was shocked to find out or discover that, you know, they were painted by an autistic artist.
Oh my goodness.
I thought, well, you know, this is something that should be shared. But I would say that that's definitely a passion of mine.
Great.
Jazz, of course. Can't leave jazz out.
Jazz, all right. Are you working on anything new? What's next on the on your agenda?
Well, I always have story plots and character portraits running around in my mind. So, yes, I do have another novel in the works, but it's classified, so stay tuned.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Maroa, for taking the time to talk with me here on Writers on Writing. Again, the title of the book is Time of the Locust, which comes out today, and it's published by Atria Books, and the author is Maroa Yejide.
MOROWA YEJIDE.
YEJIDE.
Please visit, please find out more at www.morowayejide.com.
Moroa, thank you so much. I really appreciate your coming on the program. And I want to thank you. Congratulations on the book. I wish you all the best with it. And I'm looking forward to seeing the next project.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Clarence.
All right. Take care. This has been Writers on Writing. My name is Clarence Reynolds, sitting in for Dr. Brenda Greene. I'd like to thank Mr. Fitz Richardson, our engineer here at WNYE 91.5 FM. Again, tune in every Sunday for Writers on Writing, the program that gives you the insight on what writers are writing about and what readers are reading. Thank you so much. We look forward to seeing you next week. Again, remember, writers are always reading and readers are always writing. Empower yourselves as both writers and readers. Have a good day.
Song was inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes. And he wrote a poem about rivers. And we call this song, I've Known Rivers.